हेलो फ्रेंड्स, माय नेम इज सुमित। 3 days अगो फार्मर्स फ्रॉम डिफरेंट पार्ट्स ऑफ हरियाणा, पंजाब एंड वेस्टर्न यूपी गैदर्ड अराउंड दिल्ली टू कोमेमोरेट द 1 year कम्प्लीशन ऑफ किसान मूवमेंट विच स्टार्टेड ऑन 26th ऑफ नवंबर 2020। सो रिसेंटली सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट हैज डिसाइडेड टू डू अवे विद दोज 3 फार्म लॉज। सो I'm going to discuss about those 3 farm laws, what were they all about, and what exact apprehensions farmers had or still have, and what exactly government was trying to bring in, what reforms they were trying to seek through those 3 farm laws. The first act, which is this Farmers Produce Trade and Commerce Act 2020, it stated that farmers would no more be compelled to sell their produce within the premises of those state-specific designated mandis. Second, it proposes electronic trading platform. And third, it prohibits state to levy any kind of charge like mandi fees or any cess or any charge whatsoever on those farmers who would be selling their produce outside those mandis. If you have not understood anything so far, don't worry, I'm going to make it look very simple for you. So basically, our constitution has, so first I'm going to tell you, so our constitution has 3 lists. First is union list, second is state list, and third is concurrent list. So there are some subjects, so basically a union list has certain subjects which are mentioned in this list. And these are the subjects on which only central legislature, that is Parliament of India, can legislate upon. In the state list, there are certain subjects on which only state legislature can make laws. And the subjects which are mentioned in the concurrent list, both central and state legislature can make laws upon. So far so good, right? So several states in distant past have made state specific APMC acts. APMC stands for Agricultural Produce Marketing Committee. So they have, through these very acts, they have created these committees who take care of how the procurement and how the trading takes place in those designated mandis. So you can call them APMC mandis also, or market yards or market areas. So what used to happen, as I told you, that these APMC acts, see, state to state, some variations you might see in those state specific APMC acts, but generally these acts prohibit farmers to sell their produce outside those mandis, or similar structure which is very much similar to the mandi. So maybe they are referring to some Gramin Haats or rural haats, Gramin markets, if I am not mistaken. So the problem which states highlight is that they tell that, okay, look, Parliament, who are you to make legislate upon something on which only state legislature has prerogative? So agriculture is part of state list, and this markets and fairs, so these APMC mandis are nothing but market areas, I told you. So on which only state legislature has right to make law upon. So they tell, okay, who are you to make law on something on which only state legislature has right to make law upon? And then central government affirmed in reply that, look, interstate trade and commerce is a part of union list, the entry number 42, the serial number 42. This interstate trade and commerce is part of union list. So central government says, okay, look, we are just trying to promote interstate trade, and that is very much in our legislative competence, so you cannot restrict us. So that is why these all matters are for judiciary to decide. That's why Supreme Court decided to suspend the ordinance in January 2021, this year. So 10 months ago. So this is the first issue states are highlighting. Second is, they say that if farmers would be selling directly to the traders through online platform, they would not be, since you are prohibiting us to levy any charges, then states would be deprived of that revenue. So that is also one reason why they are worried about. The third apprehension, which is from the farmer side, they feel that, okay, fine, farmers would be, you know, trading with multiple traders across the states, and this would, you know, promote interstate trade. It's fine. Farmers would have multiple options, and, you know, they would have like better choice, like larger number of the traders would be, the better choice they would have. And it appears a win-win situation for end users and farmers also, right? But then they see that, okay, with the coming of these traders, what if this APMC structure gets dismantled? Because APMC would be facing competition from those traders, right? And what if they get dismantled with passage of time? Not now, maybe not 5 years later, maybe within 10 years, if they get dismantled or within short period, then these farmers would not be getting MSPs, which they get after selling the crops in those designated mandis, because procurement is going to take place there only, right? So farmers' apprehension is that. So I've shared some of the genuine apprehensions that are there. Now let me tell you the benefits of this first act. As I told you that, you know, farmer would not be paying any such fees which state government used to levy first. So it is going to help to increase their income to some extent. Second is, earlier they used to face multiple intermediaries, as I told you. जब किसान पहले मंडी जाता था तो ही यूज टू फेस मल्टीपल इंटरमीडियरीज, उनको कमीशन एजेंट्स को कमीशन भी देना पड़ता था, तो वो कमीशन भी उनको पे नहीं करना पड़ेगा. सेकेंड थर्ड दे वुड हैव लॉट ऑफ ट्रेडर्स टू सेल देयर एग्रीकल्चर प्रोड्यूस, सो दे वुड हैव मल्टीपल ऑप्शंस, सो बेटर प्राइस डिस्कवरी वुड टेक प्लेस. एंड फोर्थ इज यू नो, लेट मी टेल यू वट इज दिस फॉर्म टू फॉक form to fork markup. So this measure is this is a measure to decide the difference between the price which end consumers pay and the price which farmers receive. So if farmer is receiving say 100 rupees for his commodity, and if the end user is paying 165 rupees for that commodity, then you can say that there's a lot difference, right? So that 65% would be the farm to fork markup. Fork is nothing, kind of the spoon which you use, right? And that is used by the end users. So farm to fork markup would be reduced with the coming up of this new act. So and you know, this would actually, you know, this would also help making our agricultural products competitive. And thus, it would help in enhancing our exports, which would result in higher net foreign exchange. So, kind of a win-win situation. So, these are some of the good points about this first act. And, you know, competition is always healthy, right? So, if traders would come, then it is going to compel the state government to, you know, do away with those extra charges which they levy. And otherwise, you know, APMCs would really be, you know, going out of the business. So they would have only one option, that you reduce those extra charges, and in that case, farmers would be more or less indifferent between selling here or there, right? Basically, farmers are not prohibited to sell in agriculture mandis. They would be just given the option to sell outside the mandis. Well, now this act has been done away with, so I should not say would. It would happen, it should have happened, but anyways, so the second act, which is this, let me tell you, this is Farmers Empowerment and Protection Agreement of Price Assurance and Farm Services Act 2020. I have collected some granular statistics, so that's why I'm referring. I have, you know, noted down some statistics. So this basically, this law is about promoting contract farming. So what is contract farming? Basically, farmer and one trader or number of traders, they are going to come together and, you know, set out some conditions that, okay, sponsor or this, you can call it sponsor or a corporate buyer or some trader who's going to tell farmer, okay, look, I'm going to purchase this agriculture produce a few months down the line from you at this predetermined price. And well, the quality of the standard should be of such scale. The quality should be of such like such nature. So all those things are going to be decided beforehand. And as I told you that, prices are also going to be determined. So that is the major point about this act. Second, it states that if, God forbids, if the settlement does not take place, and if one of the parties or both the parties are not satisfied with the from either of them, then they would have recourse to this conciliation board, which would be comprised of representatives of different parties. And if any outcome does not take place from there onwards, then they can go to SDM, and he would decide that what should be the next course of action. And even if no outcome takes place from there onward, then they can go to some appellate authority which would have been established. So that's the major two points about this act. Now, this act also has some loopholes, I would say, because this act, as you see, the second point, which is the if I'm not wrong, this is Section 19. Yes, Section 19 of this act, it prohibits the jurisdiction of civil courts. So basically, SDM would be deciding the next course of action if conciliation board is not going to resolve the thing. There is no role of any civil court whatsoever. So we know that these corporate big buyers, they are going to they might be in that position to influence the this SDM, which is now no one but new IS recruit and permanent executive. So he might be easily influenced. And so basically, farmers have this big apprehension that they might be at the mercy of these corporate buyers. So that's the one big issue, which is very genuine issue. So they should have given the jurisdiction. They should have involved the jurisdiction of civil courts. I know jurisdiction has judiciary has its own problem. They are already overburdened with number of cases. But I mean, this cannot be that pretext of keeping civil courts out of the purview of this act. And then second thing is that, recently, like many years back, you remember that this PepsiCo has refused to take potatoes from some of the Gujarat farmers on the pretext that the potatoes are of not that size which they demanded from them to produce. So these kind of things can happen going ahead also. What if those agricultural buyers, decide to not take crops from the farmers? Then farmers would have nowhere to go. They would be like left high and dry. So that's the second problem. Then now let me talk about the major advantages of this. See, as I told you that see, basically, if they are going to engage in some kind of contract, then farmer would have some idea that what kind of price or what level of price he would be getting after the end of crop cycle, because prices are determined beforehand, right? So price volatility will be reduced to some extent, to a large extent, in fact, right? Second, that it is going to streamline the supply chain to a large extent. Again, it is going to help our products competitive, and exports will be, we'll see a reasonable spike in years to come. So these are some of the benefits. And yes, the most important thing I forgot to tell you, these buyers would also be in position to provide these farmers technology inputs like seeds, fertilizers, power, and they would be giving them other sort of assistance. So they would be providing them some seeds also, some machines also. They would be providing them credit also. So then farmers would not have to resort to local money lenders, which they sometimes, and these local money lenders, they charge very high exorbitant interest rate from the farmers. But with the coming up of this act, Contract Farming Act, well, farmers would be able to access credit like without meeting like at reasonable interest rates. So that's also quite a good thing. But the farmers also have this apprehension that if they do not meet the conditions and their land might be, recovered by the big buyers. But there are some there is one section 15 of this same act, which states which prohibits the buyers to recover land from the farmers. But then they also link this settlement to the credit which is being provided to the farmers, for which they might need to put their land as a mortgage. So there is some things are not pretty much clear there. So farmers are genuinely apprehended, as you can genuinely have some apprehensions, as you can see. So this was the second act. Now let me talk about the third act, which is Essential Commodity Amendment Act. As the name itself suggests, it seeks to amend the previous act, Essential Commodity Amendment Act 2020. It seeks to exclude certain crops from the list of essential commodities, and these crops would be cereals, pulses, edible oil seeds, and other crops, right? So basically, if those commodities would not be there in the list of essential commodities, then government would not be in position to impose stock limits. So in that case, these buyers would be in position to hold the food grains, and that might not be even helpful for end consumers, because it would cause some inflation concerns. There are some other reasons also why they try to bring this law, because you see, it, like 2 years back, I remember India incurred 92,000 crore loss, post-harvest loss, 92,000 crore worth of post-harvest loss India incurred 2 3 years ago. I don't remember the exact year, but this has been the norm that India generally incurs this 20-25% of agriculture produce as loss, because we don't have enough storage facilities. And you see, government is already busy in allocating resources for infrastructure, for making bridges, for making for purchasing defense equipments. Government has already very limited wherewithal, not to mention the fiscal FRBM Act obligations. They also need to be worried about this high fiscal deficit, right? So government does not have much wherewithal. So generally, these are the responsibilities of private sector to invest in storage facilities. But till the time these stock limits would be till the time the fear of the stock limits would be there, we won't be witnessing any huge private investment in storage facilities. So that is also one of the reason government tried to bring this law, that they have excluded certain crops, and that would send some signal to the market players that okay, fine, you can now invest in storage facilities. And if there would be storage facilities, then that would make our products very competitive in international markets. But this is not the end of the story. Even in this case, there are some genuine apprehensions which farmers have. So basically, if so there is a possibility that these big players would be buying cheap and selling at dear prices. So they might be hoarding grains and tell the farmers, okay, look, we have there's not much demand. So farmer would have no option but to sell at cheap prices, and then they would be selling those or releasing those food grains when prices would be high. So this would also leave farmers little disturbed, and as they would be at the receiving end, they would be basically doing this distress sales, right? So and I already told you that this might cause some inflation during that time. So these are some of the apprehensions which farmers have. Yes, and the most heated debate revolves around this MSP. Okay, so now even now, when central government has decided to do away with these three laws, many farmer leaders are insisting on this demand that MSP should be legalized. So you see, MSPs cannot be legalized. Why don't you understand this? MSPs cannot be legalized. They are asking that, you impose this requirement upon even private players. Well, if you make it mandatory for even private players to pay you at least minimum threshold price, private players are not going to come forward. And in that case, and as I told you, that government has already very limited wherewithal, limited resources. So they would be definitely not in that position to purchase all those crops at minimum threshold price. That is also one of the reasons why it has no legal backing. This MSP system was started in 1965. India was at war with two countries, 1962 China, 1965 Pakistan. That's why Lal Bahadur Shastri ji said, Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan. India was struggling. India was, we were importing food grains from other countries. Right? So this system, this whole procurement system was built then. The times are not the same. At that time, we had to procure, right? We were in such so dire need to procure crops. But today, government, central government, state government, they have other tasks to do. If private player is not going to come forward, and if government is not in position to procure, then farmers are not going to even get what they are getting today. So they would be getting even lower prices, and this is going to hurt them even more. That's why agriculture economists like Dr. Ashok Gilati, who has done who has spent 20 years of his research for the welfare of farmers, is a known agriculture economist. He put up the same point that this would be damaging. This would be completely against the fundamentals of demand and supply dynamics. And if you say that if you are going to make it only for government, then even in that case it's problematic. That's why, this MSP generally takes place only for a handful of crops: rice, wheat, and few more crops, and that too only from few states: Haryana, Punjab, and recently other states like Chhattisgarh, MP. They've also started, thanks to this decentralization procurement scheme, which helps central government to shift the to delegate the responsibility to the state government to procure crops themselves, and then engage in PDS operations themselves. So all I want to say is that government is really not in a position to procure these crops. And let me tell you one thing: if you are going to make it mandatory for the crops, then what about the other crops? Then other producers would also start demanding the same thing. Would it be the right thing? First of all, it is not fiscally, if it is not, financially, it is not viable. That's the first thing. Second, it does not set the right precedent for the other producers. They are also going to raise the same demand. You'll be shocked that, with due to this MSP only, see, Punjab has reached a saturation level. Punjab, in Punjab state, due to this MSP only, Punjab is mainly growing what? Wheat and rice. What is this? This is nothing but monoculture farming, which is not very good ecological practice. Rice, they are producing mainly rice, right? Rice is water guzzling. It requires a lot of consumption of water. And that is also one of the reasons why Punjab is witnessing groundwater depletion. These are all the consequences of MSP. Government is trying to procure MSP only from this handful of states because they are in the need. They have to engage in this PDS operations, right? So now you can ask, now you will ask me what should be the leeway. Well, the leeway is that there are some other measures which are in place. Government has, like, we already have this price stabilization scheme where government steps in and try to procure the crops from the farmers whenever the price of the crops fell by more than 10%. So government steps in and tries to intervene until the price elevate enough above the threshold, right? So these measures are there, right? So now I have taken up most of the things, and I don't know whether I've covered this in video itself or not. Only 6% of the farmers are receiving MSPs. Only 6%. And majorly, these are the large farmers who are taking the benefit of MSPs, because small farmers, 86% of our farmers are small farmers. They own only less than 2 hectares land. So they are so small that they do not have enough marketable surplus. What is marketable surplus? Basically, so if, suppose if I cultivate some crop, so if I'm a small producer, I'm mainly going to use that output for my self-consumption. So I would have limited output left to sell in the market. So I basically, I would have limited marketable surplus. But these are the only large farmers who have this marketable surplus. Right. So first, 6% of the farmers are only availing the benefit of MSP, because you know, government itself is not in position to, you know, they announce MSP for 23 crops, but they are not procuring the crops at MSP for all the 23 crops. They are procuring only handful of crops, and that too only from handful of states. And asking for this legislative mandate would be a very daunting task for government to do. They would not be doing it. This is not fiscal. This is not financially viable. I think the focus should be on, you know, making you know, the entire ecosystem so strengthened. Suppose there should be more focus on, you know, private and public investment in agriculture. There should be more focus on investment in research and development. There should be more focus upon shifting away from this handful of crops to other crops, so that this monoculture would not be much there. So you should start focusing on producing other crops which are also more nutritious, like pulses. Focus should be there. Focus should be on investing in storage facilities. Okay. Focus should be on strengthening this online trading platform, which would bring farmers in the right position to come up with a better and high bargaining power. So ENAM is a very good measure which government has taken, but it rides on this APMC only. So but yes, other trading platforms should be brought up, and that would really put farmers in a good, better position. So that, as I told you, that farm to fork markup, that should be reduced. So focus should be on enhancing the productivity, right? So already, our entire nation is dependent, entire agriculture is dependent on monsoon. We receive like 75% of the rain within 3 months of monsoon. So already, having our own problems with this climate change. So it's a very high time to, I have a lot to say on this topic, but it's a very sensitive topic. Nevertheless, farmers' interest is should be taken care of. You know, they almost 43% of our workforce depend upon agriculture and light sector for their livelihood. So that should be taken care of. Hopefully, government would consult with all the stakeholders and come up with new measures in times to come. If anywhere I misinterpreted anything, or if you want to add any comment, please feel free to drop your comment. Thank you so much. Thanks for your time.